Interview with Maarit, a Scandinavian MyLab. April 7, 2011. By Eve Lorgan. Synopsis of Maarit's interview. Disclaimer, this is a witness testimony of a military abductee rehab, and contains disturbing material and is not recommended reading for those who cannot handle the reality of malevolent alien abductions or shadow government activities. I cannot vow to the absolute facts of all of this testimony nor all of Maarit's opinions. This is offered as another piece of the puzzle exploring the MyLab issue and as an extension of the work of the late Dr. Carla Turner and Barbara Bartholik, as well as my own contribution. It is not meant to be fear-based but as a wake-up call testimony to acknowledge those who should not have to live lives of harassment, oppression, and secrecy. This interview is with a female MyLab abductee from Scandinavia named Maarit. She chose to use a pseudonym to protect her anonymity. She contacted me in late 2010 to share her testimony of alien abductions and subsequent military abductions following her pregnancy with her son in 2005. I interviewed Maarit because she is one of a handful of very lucid abductees, who can recall a greater degree of her abduction-related experiences without the use of hypnosis. Although she has neuroimmunological health issues related to multiple sclerosis, I believe her to be mentally intact and credible. She is also highly psychic and can lucid dream the ability to be conscious and aware during the dream state, which enabled her to regain greater degrees of awareness during her alien and military abductions. A large component of her military abductions involve being used as a guinea pig with colluding pharmaceutical medical companies who work in conjunction with the shadow government on MyLabs. Maarit shares her understanding of how and why she is genetically modified, a hybrid if you will, and how this figures into her neurophysiologic and immunological issues with multiple sclerosis, and an Rh-negative blood type. Maarit explains how her life and marriage have been completely orchestrated by her alien handlers who are primarily draconian, reptilian and military. She has observed many species of ETs in her experiences and recalls being in dumps, deep underground military bases, and a nuclear silo with dark-winged, draconian entities. She discusses her understanding of the genetic and energetic soul matrix, vibrational aspects of hybrids and the alien soul recycling technology. She had an experience similar to Ted Rice of Dr. Carla Turner's Masquerade of Angels, involving having her consciousness transferred into a black box and placed into a cloned body. Although hybrid issues are now a focal interest in current abduction research, she asserts the most important aspects we need to focus on is how aliens, specifically reptilians, can manipulate, orchestrate, and interfere with our relationships. Maarit awakened to her experiences after more memories surfaced, which triggered the realization of malevolent and mind-controlling elements in her abductions. The use of virtual reality, VRE, brain entrainment technology is done to control consciousness, and is hooked up once an abductee is implanted. One of her screen memories installed by draconian entities involved seeing beatific, new agey, dolphin scenes upon awakening from an abduction experience. Beneath this screen memory was an abduction in an underground base. She admitted to having previously promoted popular benevolent ET experiences on a Scandinavian radio talk show before becoming lucid to the reality of the deceptive, mind-controlling nature of her abductions. Now, she is fighting back, regaining her lucidity and spiritual resilience. She wants us to know humans can fight back for their awareness and freedom. Awareness is the key to empowerment. One, tell me a bit about how you discovered you had ET experiences, and your initial beliefs about alien/abduction and contact? What shifted your beliefs about the true nature of ETs and your experiences, any particular incidents which broke the programming of what the more popular UFO groups and researchers were promoting? Before we start, I would like to thank Eve Lorgan for her work, which bravely goes to the dark side of this alien phenomena. I contacted her while I was frustrated and tired. Her open heart and integrity as a researcher and therapist made a huge impact on me. I consider our intensive correspondence as a major turning point in my life. She offered her presence for a total stranger, not so many willing to do these days. In the UFO field, there are not so many researchers who are willing to step out of the comfort zone of contactee-oriented happy UFO scenarios. Only by realizing the alien manipulative agenda we can achieve autonomy for our consciousnesses as a human race. First of all, I consider myself to be an abductee being unwillingly used by aliens and military for several purposes. Because I have been manipulated, drugged, and mind-controlled by humans and aliens, I do not use the term contactee. In my experiences, there is no reciprocal nuance to be observed as in cases of alleged contactee people. I do not consider myself to be special or chosen in any way. I don't have any channeled information to offer. All I can offer is question after question. When I refer to term shadow government slash people, I mean globally operating companies related to medical warfare operatives as well as factions of military slash intelligent groups. Which ones, I don't know for certain. I can divide my alien encounters in two different parts. One part of this alien encounter began before I was even born. I have conscious memories of that time when I was in another subtle form of existence and forced unwillingly to manifest in this three-dimensional universe as we humans observe it now. I consider the essence of my spiritual being to be alien, per se. I remember how I was shown different parental alternatives to choose from. The connecting link between these human couples was some sort of DNA structure. My consciousness moved into my infant human body just before labor, and I was fully aware of these memories even when I was a baby. After a while, the normal neurological adjusting began and I saw myself as a normal child with heightened psychic abilities. The second part of my human experience with alien encounters began in childhood at 4 years old, and I knew I was not alone. When I woke up, there was blood on my pillow and I knew somebody stuck something into my nose. I constantly saw scary dreams and woke up in terror. These things happened during the time when I was 4 to 7 years old. But as funny as it sounds, during the childhood I do not have any clear memories of these beings that were terrorizing me or how they looked like. But when I saw a picture of a UFO, I knew they were the ones. Another wave of consciously remembered encounters happened, as usual, during my teens. Even as a child, I was fascinated by astronomy, nuclear physics, philosophical principles related to existence and ontology. I was more and more humanized as whole. I wanted to find the solution, the ultimate matrix for metaconsciousness, and all that I could find at that time was the New Age movement and the shallow answers it had to offer. Even when I was fairly aware of being abducted at that time, 16-30 years old, that these encounters were not benevolent, I was mentally forced to interpret my experiences as such. The New Age way to look these alien encounters during 80s and 90s was so full of subjective reasoning and pressure. Mostly because here in Scandinavia some of the UFO researchers are highly contactee oriented. And the material these certain New Age minded UFO researchers produced was directly linked to their publishing business. In Scandinavia we were not given proper options in which we could judge the characters of the alien encounters by ourselves. I was once even on the local radio telling, when I was still into the New Age perspective, about these lovely space brothers, which are here to lift our vibrations, because I did not want to be shut out from the community of friends I was related to during that period of time. At that time I was just one piece of this manipulative machinery, which was planned to misdirect people by giving them highly calculated answers to solve their nocturnal horrifying problems. And I did my job. But not with smiling face. As I got older, the abductions began to be physically more real. I could remember things, which did not suit the concept of contactee-based rhetoric. My ovum was harvested on regular basis and I saw constant marks like sudden bruises, straight cuts, triangular rashes, scoop marks, burned-like areas in my ankles, needle marks on my forehead and nose with the upper layer of dermis removed on my body after these episodes. I could not lie to myself anymore about the nature of these encounters. They were malevolent, controlling, and they affected my consciousness and memories in a suppressive manner. Not once was I given a straight answer by the abductors for the alien agenda. At that time I found myself being alone. Suddenly after that conscious realization, of questioning the aliens' motives as not being good, was when I was isolated mentally and socially via certain episodes in my life. I was carrying a secret no one publicly would respond to in the UFO field here in Scandinavia. so I felt I was living a private hell in front of many ignorant eyes. The shift from New Age beliefs to more an objective state of mind was subtle but very solid and inevitable concerning my realization of the true nature of these alien abductions. The MyLab involvement, however, began when I was pregnant 5 years ago, in 2005-06. At that time I had no knowledge of this MyLab scenario at all. I did not know what was going on because the UFO researchers in Scandinavia neglect this subject and there is no open discussion about this military involvement at all in my country. We have only one New Age magazine, which promotes tarot readers and light-hearted contacts and their supporters in UFO community. I just wondered about this sudden appearance of military and medical personnel during my abductions. The focal point of consciously realizing my MyLab connection was the precipitating incident, which coincidentally delayed my multiple sclerosis diagnosis 2 years ago. My diagnosis was not given in proper ways, because my cauda equina operation was initially delayed and there was a professional error made by a local doctor. The surgery left me with an untreated infection, which created a permanent inflammatory problem with the central nervous system. The unbelievable doctor's behavior caused a huge amount of mental stress and a short episode of dissociation, which affected the way my brains functioned. This actually caused me to remember things I should not have. I became conscious in a way the shadow government would not want me to be. In hindsight, I realize many of these major events and turning points of my life are produced and controlled by aliens. And this is the most important factor I'm going to pinpoint out later. 2. Why do you believe or have you been told by the aliens or military handlers why they are using you in their experiments? Are you a hybrid or genetically modified by aliens? The aliens have used me because I live in a genetically modified body. My physical existence offers an opportunity for the aliens to make genetic surveillance in a multi-generational way. When I say genetically modified, it is my understanding that this means an alteration of DNA so that the nervous system modified with alien DNA and energetic body as well can sustain the alien consciousness, because only this kind of consciousness can make a hybrid body functional, per se. This is actually part of the soul recycling technology. When I say I am a hybrid, I understand myself. My consciousness is something you refer to as draconian. I was obligated before birth to move into an altered body to fulfill my task. To perform that transition, I had to choose the human parents too, as long as the mother was a blood type Rh negative factor. This immunological trait is a common feature among these so-called draconians and their reproduction. But having an Rh negative blood type doesn't mean you are a hybrid, it's just a necessary condition to carry on the biological technology. The genetic modification is very tied to CNS functions and immunological moderation. This alien genetic factor includes modification of consciousness, aka vibrational aspects of soul/consciousness matrix as well. The soul matrix is a vibration like electricity in that it can be observed as tones of frequencies. The question of genetic alteration is not purely physical, as we understand. It includes vibrational factors as well. My understanding of draconian DNA is that it is basically inorganic, unlike the human DNA. The draconian body DNA function needs radiation to sustain consciousness like humans need air to breathe. The draconian DNA structure is not a spiral alpha helix but a denser form of some inorganic and energetic matter, which could be described as a quadrangle. With this quadrangle, the structures of energetic tones are organized to serve bodily functions. I believe this is why there have been procedures done to human DNA balancing the functions and partitions of inorganic and organic matter within DNA. The fundamental building blocks for life are not quite what we have been told, apparently. So, true hybrids have alien consciousness in an altered body via a genetic CNS modification. CNS modification is partly needed to handle the frequencies of alien consciousness with the energetic body. The alteration of CNS genetics is done outside the womb during the impregnation by technology, which can hold and change the soul matrix via magnetic field. The modified embryo is then implanted inside the womb of the Rh-negative female. The different kind of alien soul matrix revives the function of the hybrid body and altered CNS function. All hybrids are psychic. So you may understand why the real hybrids are keeping the secret and silence. The various produced beings, through hybrid bodies, are altered outside the womb during the embryonic stage for other things as well, such as functioning in a different kind of environment, and they have higher tolerance for radiation as well. The radiation itself is not poison to some ET races at all. This was shared with me before the Japanese nuclear incident on 3/11/011 at Fukushima. I have been used as an incubator for alien hybrid embryos. The Rh negative factor is the key here. Many women abductees used in this way have the Rh factor in their blood. The Rh factor prevents the possible autoimmune reaction during the early stages of alien pregnancy. Normal females are also producing human embryos for aliens. These embryos are partly grown and used as a biological protein source for repsheids. Abducted humans abductees do not need genetic alteration of they are used for other biotechnological uses and consumption for repsheids. So frankly put, as food. These reptile beings are able to grow large amounts of biologically alive tissue. This tissue can be cloned to make manufactured gray beings as well. This kind of tissue cannot be cloned forever without degeneration. That's why the aliens are abducting so many humans. All of us have to satisfy the need of food for a large alien civilization. It's so simple. We are not on the top of the food chain. This is something we just have admit to ourselves. Many abductees tell us about the baby presentations made by the aliens. The whole thing, in my opinion, is just meant to do some psychological bonding to prevent resistance of human beings. Nothing more. The babies presented, as more mature babies, are probably human-alien hybrids made to use as servants later on. My son is being abducted as well. He is genetically modified too. His birth was a miracle. We had to use ICSI method, in vitro fertilization, in order to have a vibrant embryo to be placed. During my pregnancy in alien encounters, I was introduced to my son 2 times. The body was small, his skin pale. He had huge blue eyes and only a small amount of hair. When he came to see me with this Nordic-looking figure, his consciousness was maintained in a classic hybrid-like body. And just like mine, his awareness joined the genetically altered human body during my delivery. He has described that kind of memory to me. We have an ultra-strong connection, and we communicate also by using pure feelings. Military want all the cookies I can give them, my genetics, my psychic abilities, and there is medical research being done that offers benefits for both involved parties and their cooperation as well. And they have plugged my son into their operations as well. This was the main reason I decided to share my story, to tell people to wake up and fight for their freedom. We have to understand that there are multiple participants with multiple agendas related to abduction/MyLab activity. And more, I believe, the two medical shadow groups and military are linking together. It seems to me that human participants have to work for these alien beings in ever deeper levels than was previously imagined. This is one reason why I believe there is not going to be an open disclosure about the true nature of the alien encounters. Some human factions are too deep into this mess. The disclosure would risk the economical/scientific benefits and power these groups have gained via alien connection and cooperation. When a human is abducted for a first time, he is being implanted. The military has the needed technology to track the signals emitted by the implants of these new abductees. The implants insert themselves within the central nervous system. When the connection is made, there is a signal, which the military can pick up. So, all the alien abducted people are possible MyLab victims, hence re-ABS, if they possess something that can be beneficial to the military. No one is safe and the MKUltra days are not over. The military/shadow government has the identities of every single abductee in this world. 3. What kinds of medical issues have you experienced that you believe to be due to abductions? Have you been mind controlled by them? How? Aliens have done several physical procedures. They have taken bone marrow from my neck and hip with a long needle. They have collected ovum. They have put an implant into my nostril. They have collected tissue samples from my arm and knee. Psychologically, they have erased my memories and installed fake ones. They have used what felt like electrical vibrations straight into my frontal lobe to do mind control. One morning I found a puncture mark in the middle of my forehead, after having strong feelings to not look in the mirror, suggestions by them to not look into the mirror, and when I saw the mark, I remembered how they put some kind of electric vibration into my brain somehow through that needle, and I was told not to remember and not to talk. And then they forced me to look at images of the dolphins again from a screen-like device. I see the dolphins every time when my subconscious is trying to bring something to the surface. They have caused pure emotional horror and enjoyed the ride. I have nothing against dolphins and friendly higher intelligent species, it's just their image is being projected in screen memories to pacify our minds into complicity. I have an autoimmune inflammation in my CNS, because the inflammation of peripheral nerves went straight to the CNS, following a surgery. The diagnosis is G37.9, and still waiting to be confirmed as MS, the primary progressive form. The whole episode with the delay of the operation and the inflammation going straight to the CNS was, I believe, alien orchestrated, and my body is now being used as a guinea pig for medical pharmaceutical research done by some faction of the military/shadow government. Because my body is altered, I have degeneration in my pelvic and cervical area as well. I have had a neuropsychological evaluation twice. I'm suffering from memory problems and visual spatial problems as well. The findings refer to an organic nature of impairment. I cannot work because of my physical and neuropsychological condition. Some of these changes can be explained via MS, and some because of the mind control and the methods aliens and military use. There is no cure for this. I have been recommended for neuropsychological rehabilitation. I have been told by draconians that my body is genetically altered. My blood pressure is quite low and my average body temperature is somewhere between 35 to 35.5 degrees of Celsius. 37C equals 98.6F, so it's between 95.0-96.8F, my psychic abilities are far higher than average. I sense human emotions and thought forms as soon as I see a person. This is something I would like to get rid of, because it wears me out. I prefer solitude and vibrationally developed, disciplined emotions like gratitude, etc. Unfortunately, there are not so many people possessing these features. I believe I have also been used to test draconian weaponry modified for human military use because of my psychic abilities and vibrations. Some weapons can only be activated through psychic influence. 4. Have you recognized any of the locations you have seen in your MyLab/abduction experiences, such as DUMS, deep underground military bases, or medical facilities? Have you recognized any human personnel you have seen in your regular life accidentally? I have been in a DUM several times that I can consciously remember. One place, believe merely my own speculation, is located somewhere in Canada or in the northern part of USA. The speculation is based only on visual observation of the nature. When I got out from underground, I saw these huge trees I have seen on nature documentaries in my country. It was a mountain area, in the middle of the forest. And there was a railway entering into the DUM. The entrance was open and there was fence around the yard. The other place was a nuclear silo, in a place where nuclear weapons were stored. These places could be one and the same, but somehow I doubt that. I have seen the same medical personnel who treated me at the University Hospital, Department of Neurology, during the process of my neurological diagnosis. There is one professor of clinical neuroimmunology and neurophysiology and one medical doctor of neurology who are using me in their medical research done for the shadow government. This medical research is dealing the use of nitro oxide as a regulator in the immune response of the CNS. Nitro oxide is under constant interest in pharmaceutical work. Not to be confused with dental nitrous oxide, applications can be used in cardiovascular and pulmonary diseases and in asthma as well. There are experiments made to use the asthma medication to relieve the symptoms of MS flares. So, the connection between my condition, these doctors, and my lab abduction is to understand and regulate the immune response in the human nervous system. I believe I'm under interest because of my genetic differences too. So I'm serving multiple purposes, which I probably even don't know about. One factor in my opinion is their interest in understanding how to connect together different types of neurological tissues without creating the usual degenerative autoimmune reaction. As one can understand, the application of this information is huge. One can do the digging by themselves by Googling nitrooxide and CNS. It is all there. The professor I saw in Adum is closely connected to a major pharmaceutical company. The same company is developing a drug for narcolepsy as well, and the nitrooxide is playing an important role once again. I believe I'm used to test the narcotic influence of different medicines as well. The medical researcher I'm talking about is doing research on the neurophysiological aspects of dreams as well. I also had one very important condition they needed in their study. I did not have plagues in my brain or spinal cord. These kinds of findings are implications of the primary progressive form of MS. All the people in my area suffering from this type of illness are being sent to these specific doctors for evaluation. Surprisingly, in this specific university hospital there is a highly respected research group doing studies about the nitrooxide finding as an indicator of brain atrophy in primary progressive MS. This specific university hospital and some personnel of this research group have been doing medical research and evaluation for the military people too. So there is a huge network going on, not only nationally but globally too. And the unfortunate ones, my labs, are being plugged in. Nitrooxide No is under constant interest in pharmaceutical work. In 1998, doctors Furchgott, Ignaro, and Murad were given a Nobel Prize for their research work related to No. http://nobelprize.org/nobel_prizes/medicine/laureates/1998/press.html. Nitric oxide plays a role in immune response as well, and there is constant research being done on this subject. http://www.asahidashnet.or.jp/tildejr9h-szk/juku/juku3.pdf. The applications for NO are drugs developed and under development for neurological diseases as well, like Frampidrine for walking difficulties and muscle weakness for people suffering neurological diseases. http://www.chemicalbook.com/chemicalproductproperty_n_cb98538687.htm. Before this accident I was not interested in pharmacology in any level. I only had one conscious memory of the nurse who came to me when I was sitting on the research table, in a dumb probably. She had a needle and she injected some liquid into my right knee. "This is nitroxide. That's what I first remembered," she said. "You should not make such a fuss about things." After that I saw the same medical researcher entering the room. That's all I remember. And all I needed to remember to start to do my own checking out. I have taken photos from my knees after the nitrooxide shots as well. So, it's no wonder these events were manipulated to the point where the delayed operation caused an autoimmune response in my CNS. I was a good catch. And this is only the tip of the iceberg from the work of this hidden network. I'm sure of it. But to go deeper into this could be a story of its own. 5. What kinds of aliens are primarily working on your case? Can you describe their basic jobs and goals? Primarily Reptiids, Greys, and other aliens like mantis creatures, because they are working under draconian control. Before I continue, I have to clarify the position of reptiles and draconians in order to understand what is going on and by whom. Draconians do not conduct abductions per se as the interdimensional reptiles are doing, even they are occasionally seen in the UFO. Draconians control the reptilian race and their behavior, and the reptiles are servants for the draconians. Draconians need the hybrid bodies to be used as containers for consciousness, because only a vibrant soul matrix can reinforce manufactured hybrid bodies. There are a lot of species CO working in these scenarios, so it's difficult to define what kind of role the different ET creatures are playing from our point of view. Positive, neutral or negative. When I generally speak about hybrids, I don't know whether they are human-reptilian, human-draconian, or human-some other race/races. And the other abductees and UFO researchers don't know that for sure either. So pinpointing hybrids only as a reptilian-human origin, we can do crucial damage for the hybrid rhetoric as a whole. Reptiids are servants for the draconian race. There are not so many Dracos on Earth, physically present. I have seen them only working in this particular nuclear silo. Reptiids are allowed to use humans as a resource and do their thing as long as they don't disobey the draconian administration. By using hybrids, draconians can produce workers, biological material, etc., who knows, for their use. Reptilians do the needed work. They abduct people and hybrids for the use of cloning and further production. They have advanced technological development to do that, and they are allowed to use humans for their own purposes as well, primarily for nutrition and entertainment. By entertainment, I mean sexual activities with humans. These sexual behaviors have malevolent, sadomasochistic features. In other words, there is a vast biological industrial activity going on where humans are being used as a source for biological and psychological emotional material. The basic job for reptilian beings is to survive and carry their own cultural genetic traits. This is something we have to understand. They do what they do because they are what they are, highly intelligent beings capable of remarkable things. We have to step out of the victimized state of mind and get rid of the fear. This is the only way to get the respect of these creatures and develop a communication of some sort. Whining and unnecessary complaining are the dead end, then we start to dig our own psychological and physical grave for sure. Objectivity and courage is needed even to try to understand a different kind of intelligence and technology. This is something we are not able to do. The researchers who only feed the fear instead of objectivity are no better than the New Age people who are proclaiming easy ascension and waiting for spiritual enlightenment even while being roasted in the oven. I believe these reptilian creatures are the main problems and bullies for humans. And these reptilians do shapeshift and can take the form of these so-called Nordics as well. Draconians are far more advanced than humans are capable of even understanding. I have consciously seen dark brown draconians with wings and hoofs. They are a highly technically advanced, warrior-like race with great disciplined actions. Draconians are also philosophical creatures and can be very fearless if needed. Females are superior to male. They consider themselves to be more sophisticated than humans. Because they are ranked quite high in hierarchy of different races, we rarely see them like we see the most highly ranked bosses in our companies. They mingle with their own kind of company. I remember being in a silo barefoot, and this male draconian came to me and sent me a mental thought that he finds the human feet very big and repulsive. I found it funny, because during that episode one could not even understand where I was. Their goal is to continue their lives as a race as well. Just like we humans do. It is odd, but very often, in the My Lab Ops scenarios, we are not allowed to wear shoes, and our clothes may be lying in one place, later to be put on, but we never have our shoes. It's like we are not allowed to wear them. In my opinion, there are a couple of reasons why My Labs remember being without their shoes or clothes. One reason is the fact that some My Labs are involved with research, for example, related to radiation, and they are being decontaminated after testing. This can partly explain the memories of showers and locker rooms. The other reasons why some My Labs are not wearing shoes are the satanic rituals performed in DUM and their participation in these rituals under mind control. Being without shoes is serving ritual necessities and psychological manipulation as well. Remember the Nazi concentration camps? Reptiids are divided into interdimensional beings and some creatures that live under the surface of Earth. These creatures live in caverns and have red eyes and dark brown skin. They eat meat too. Interdimensional reptiids can shapeshift and are predator-natured. I have observed a conflict between the draconians and some reptiid party/faction. It's about power. There was a military faction assisting willingly or unwillingly, I'm not sure, and these specific reptiid groups are trying to overcome the draconian leadership, because the draconians are in charge of some nuclear military dumps too. If this reptilian rebellion is proceeding, I'm feeling worried, because this would mean the total loss of control made by draconians. Reptiids would be allowed to mess around, and even the shadow government would not be safe. If considering this as a chess game, the situation is not pleasant from the human point of view. But this is merely my speculation. I saw the power struggle personally during an abduction. The draconian entity came to stop the Repsheids and prevented them from using me somehow. This has happened 2 times. So I guess I have something to offer to these draconians and shadow government, and that's why they keep an eye on me. The Repsheids have expressed very violent activities towards me and some other abductees I have seen on the UFO, like beating, etc. I believe they are having a hard time trying to suppress their basic need to kill. And that's why some abductees are reporting very disturbing violent abductions and treatment. The degeneration of personality traits and grappling for power applies to other species as well. By this degeneration I mean the need to produce unnecessary suffering while enjoying it. There is also an original gray race, per se. They are workers for these reptilian entities. And there are a huge amount of manufactured gray look-alike beings used for physical labor. They are being manufactured inside a dome and some are being transported to other locations. Six many my labs and now the popularized super soldiers have described being used as operatives under mind control physically across the globe and even off-world. They also describe virtual reality experiences, a term popularized by the late Dr. Carla Turner. Can you tell me if you can tell the difference between a true physical abduction, and one that is virtual reality? Yes. But this is only my experience. In my case, true physical abductions leave marks. Something is done to my physical body. Sometimes there can be menstrual irregularities and abdominal pain, bruises, needle marks, scars, etc. The consciousness is totally controlled during these episodes. I can remember flashes of 1 to 10 seconds. Then I remember being shut down. My field of observation is narrowed. I can sometimes see clearly tiny areas at one time, like clear small windows of clarity in a limited field of vision. Sometimes I can feel being moved and pushed even when I'm unable to open my eyes or when I'm in a dreamlike state. In physical abductions I get more of a drugged feeling and less clear memory, and lots of blank spots in between. Most of the time these memories, whether physical or virtual reality, are very hard to separate because of the consciousness control. Nowadays military don't walk into your house anymore. Trust me. They can open a time/space portal and pick you up so that you don't even notice. The main objective for these aliens is not to be noticed. They prefer to stay in the shadows, because otherwise humans could start to do preventative actions to stop the abductions by strengthening their lucidity, using and developing proper technology for resistance. So we are not dealing with gods. We are dealing with mortal entities. In the virtual reality experiences, it is as real as watching a movie or living an everyday life, with no observable limitations. With lucidity, realizing you are dreaming, you can wake up from this scenario. In VRE there is always some aspect of strangeness involved if one is able to recognize this. By this I mean, for an example, a different kind of phone you have never seen before, strangers, furniture, etc. By recognizing these, you can achieve lucidity and wake up in your bed. But this is hard, because the VRE is produced in your brains by using methods like signals and electrical stimulation, which affects your neural and muscular function as well. This makes the scenario seem even more real. And physical/mental adjustment is being done under VRE situations. This makes the scenario seem even more real. And physical/mental adjustment is being done under VRE situations. By this I mean psychological conditioning on how to act or control oneself during RV operations, behavioral modification on how to handle fear, tolerate pain, etc. True physiological modification, implanting, is being done either in a dome or in a UFO. Repsheids use VRE for harvesting emotions too. This happens by causing horrifying VRE experiences for abductees. The military and aliens as well can produce VRE by sending signals to implants. Military can change these induced brainwaves into images and sounds on a screen. Aliens don't need that kind of technology, because they sense these telepathically. I have been able to observe the exact moment when I'm being activated for the use. This happens when I'm going to sleep. Just when my brainwaves are starting to change for a sleep mode, I see a flash of bright light in my mind's eye, even with eyes shut. Usually the scene in my eyes change and I get an impression of an open space in front of my closed eyes. I can also see from what kind of interior I'm been plugged into. So there is a radar-like computer network through which abductees can be controlled. There is also portable equipment that have antenna, which can send the VRE signals too. And some factions of the perpetrators are using this for their own purposes. I believe the connection can function in two ways. Once the abductee is able to use heightened psychic capacity and lucidity, one can attain information from the other party by doing remote viewing. I have been able to this once and then I saw the warehouse from where the signal was sent. One has to understand that we are dealing with high technology, which most people don't know even the moderate applications can be seen in a use in everyday life. For example, one official branch of this technology is being introduced to people as different kinds of computer-related appliance for handicapped people. One can do their own research on this subject if interested. 7. Have you ever been tasked by your MyLab controllers to do remote viewing? If so, how is this experience compared to the entrained VRE scenarios? Yes, I have. I have been sent to observe some alien creatures, draconian related, several times. I have also been used for more mundane issues like checking some locks or paper documents. These were written in English that I could remember. Remote viewing is produced either by physical abuse and splitting of consciousness, or by using the VRE related technology. Consciousness can be separated and moved by using some sort of electrical vibration. I can tell the difference between the RV from VRE by observing the visual scene I'm seeing. In RV my vision is somehow truly controlled. It feels to me, like I'm watching the environment through a bottle. The vision is somehow twisted and distorted. I see only the things I'm told to observe. I can do some conscious reasoning during these episodes as well. Sometimes there can be unwanted reaction and the RV situation is slipping into a spontaneous out-of-the-body experience. When this happens, I hear a buzzing sound in my ears and I have problems controlling the movements of my energy body. I can slip through the walls recklessly until I'm being drawn back to my body. Also, in RV there is seldom any physical sensations, pain etc., present. Naturally. So only by lucidity and deep reflection one can discern these different kinds of phenomena. Very often, remote viewing and virtual reality they are also linked together. 8. What do you think is going on with the hybrid issue as popularized by Dr. David Jacobs in his alien abduction case histories? Have you seen alien-human hybrids in your experiences? What do you believe is their real function? When we are talking about the hybrid issue, we have to understand that as a human race we don't really have the complete picture of this issue. There are not as many genetically different alien-related hybrids on Earth as the some researchers are stating. That's for sure. To say alien hybrids are all malevolent, suffering from severe personal disorders is as narrow-minded approach as New Agers have, when saying that alien agenda is good and hybrids are a way to save humankind. Nonsense. Based on what I have experienced, true alien hybrids are here to serve the surveillance of the genetic study made by the alien race. Hybrids are not meant to infiltrate into human society to fulfill some hidden purposes of draconians or reptiles. This is something one has to understand. Hybrids are used just to produce more hybrids for the use of draconians. Hybrids are used like machines in draconian bioindustry. We have no knowledge why this alteration is being made. Our social or emotional life per se is not under interest of any kind. Hybrids of the more alien types I mentioned live their lives in different societies like other people do. When I speak about hybrids I consider them to be draconian / alien consciousnesses in an altered human body. But I'm sure that reportoids have their own breeding program going on which is something draconians consider not suitable behavior rebellion. So yes, there are reptilian hybrids reptilian consciousnesses in human altered bodies. And then there are genetic mixtures of many other races as well made by Dracos, which are not connected to human race at all. According to my understanding and memories, we cannot define a hybrid just by observing the differences of the DNA structures between hybrids and humans, because some of the changes are energetic in nature, as I said before. The major difference is the heightened psychic ability compared to other human beings. When I say I consider myself to be alien hybrid, aka a genetically modified human with alien soul matrix consciousness, I know there should be a genealogist to confirm my statement to make this official proof. It is not even important to me, because I have to live an ordinary everyday life anyway, and of course deal with the constant interference in my life. I do not see myself mean or malevolent in any way. Neither is my son. But people who are acting like judges, I consider to be dangerous. There is no room for hypocrisy. Humans manipulate, torture, neglect and abuse their kind in similar ways that these Repsheids are doing to achieve their own agenda. Wake up time. Instead of this, we should concentrate on real issues, which are the alien manipulation through their hive-like almost organic influence and the possessions they can take over certain individuals. These things have nothing to do with hybrids per se, like the ones I've defined. There can also be observed people with low vibrations and lack of integrity acting and playing with abductees. This has nothing to do with hybrids as well, and the hybrid issue is something I consider to be less important in the field of abduction research. Wrong conclusions only create unnecessary fear. Only by seeing the overall impact of this alien manipulation we can start to live our own lives in a more compassionate way. We need to find the true humanity of our own kind and not be willing to be an amusement for them to give them the vibes or emotional reactions that the Repsheids like. Another thing we have to wake up to understand is that the alien modification with hybrids, aka genetically modified human abductees, starts before physical manifestation, such as in vitro before birth or while in the womb, and is carried on constantly in hybrids' lives. This means one can observe certain patterns in hybrids and abductees. 1. The abductors are creating an environment where the hybrid and/or abductee is often emotionally and socially isolated, either geographically or by parents. This provides them convenient ground to influence the life patterns of the hybrid and repress possible interference made by other human beings. Experimental control. 2. They often set up a love affair to mate the hybrid or abductee with a suitable candidate. Through this selected person, aliens can control the action of a hybrid, aka genetically modified human abductee. This usually means that true hybrids are being kept hidden by preventing them from having a major position in modern society. This can be made by disrupting and orchestrating their education, relationships, and health, as was done in my case. So as one can understand, there is no glory to be had in this hybrid issue. There is only suffering if these patterns are not revealed and worked through, so as to gain personal and social integration of a hybrid person. Secrecy and isolation harms us. Many of these aspects apply to abductees as well, and can be produced by the shadow military government people too. I have seen so-called hybrids, the more alien ones only seen or existing on ships, etc., during my abductions. They were merely showing me where to go, etc. I had no conversation with them that I could consciously remember. These beings were very short and gave me an impression of physical density of some sort. In the room I saw, one of them was having modified air pressure given to them. I could imagine one can experience this by diving deep. I have also seen small horse-looking, white creatures. They were kept in containers. And the hybrids are working to collect liquid from the ligaments of these creatures. In order to understand the modern hybrid discussion, we need to accept the fact that most information is given by the abductees, who are merely reporting the facts aliens want and allow them to see and remember. And certain researchers are adding water to the mill by taking these fragment memories to form a theory. This, in my opinion, is how the distortion is made and facts are neglected. We simply don't know what kind of genetic experiments are being done and by whom. 9. Have you observed the alien possession of a human situation, such as the term reptilian hosting being used? Yes, I have. I did not know the name for this subject until recently. Before going deeper into this issue, I have to tell that Eve Lorgan has gone straight into the heart of this alien discussion. Really. She has openly formed a view of alien manipulation, which I find to be true in my life. After I realized that, I was able to form some kind of synthesis made from my life. I did not know the idea or concept of alien love bite until recently, but these three little words changed my life and showed me the way to self-realization and more awareness to fight for autonomy in my life. Alien hosting does happen. Regardless of that, I always subconsciously knew this kind of phenomenon was happening in my life. By hosting, I refer to a person who is under direct influence of a reptiled being, mainly through mind control. Sometimes the reptile's spirit can enter a person's body and cause some changes in the physical appearance of the hosted person as well. Facial features can change, their voice, etc. These changes can be seen and often are observed even consciously. But mostly they are neglected because the other partner or persons close to them don't understand what is going on. I believe many hosted people are considered to suffer from psychiatric diseases like personality disorders, like narcissistic, sociopathic, psychotic behavior. Even the problems have different etiology than in normal F-code, DSM, diagnosis. In my opinion, the hosting occurs within the orchestrated relationships. It is done if there is a need from the reptiles to cause immediate influence on the hybrid/abductee's life during certain periods of time, like to have the other partner feeling emotions such as fear and abandonment. Possession occurs when the reptilian being itself wants to experience directly emotions and physical stimulus through a hybrid/abductee's body. It can occur with non-abductees too. The other term closely connected to hosting is the reptilian hive mind. The term hive mind, in my understanding, is the needed reptilian matrix or created context in hybrids lives. By this I mean that the reptiles are capable of creating a reality matrix like a Nintendo game. Reality matrix contains certain amount of freedom for abductee or hybrid to make decisions in their life, but nevertheless, the outcome is what the reptiles want it to be. By using this hive mind manipulation, many people can be included in the matrix to act as wanted for the needed result. The reptilian hive mind is being activated as a lure-like episode, often among multiple needed participants, to create the needed situations into hybrids or abductees' lives. This has happened to me many times in my life, and during these situations I felt quite powerless to change the course of the events I could already know was going to happen. The hive mind, or created reality matrix, is usually deactivated once the needed result is gained. For example, marriage in my case and the delayed surgery and so on. This can extend to sabotaged media efforts to have guests on to tell their stories, where certain aspects of the alien agenda are never allowed to be spoken in a large way in the public domain. After the deactivation of the hive mind, the people involved often seem to wake up somehow. They may feel shame about what they have done and don't seem to understand how they could not have seen the results of their behavior. In this way, the reptilians can enjoy the caused misery two times, once with hybrid or abductee and secondly with the awakened manipulated participants who, by the way, are non-abductees and are very much affected by this too and are less aware than the abductees themselves are. I could tell you examples of people who are under hosting or shape-shifting reptiles per se in my opinion, but I'd rather not. If I would start to pinpoint people, I would not act any better than people who infer all the hybrids are one bunch of sociopathic monsters. Instead, I would encourage people to judge others based on their actions, like Jesus was doing. Actions reveal the color of one's heart, not the words or appearance. My husband was under reptilian hosting and hive mind influence when we met almost 20 years ago. Without going into specific details, the pattern was clearly seen. He was compulsive, neglectful, aggressive, and he constantly created disturbance in my life during the key points in my life I considered that were critical for my work. I did a lot of work with confronting him to pull him out of the lure. The lure being the reptilian hive mind that was trying to control his behavior and thoughts. And I did a good job. Today I have great husband and we work as a team. In the early years of our relationship, he was an abductee too. There were also very intense times of paranormal activity too. I'm quite aware that aliens and the shadow government people manipulate him on regular basis. By this I mean that subconsciously he is monitoring my behavior. AKA a handler as a sleeper agent. Even while writing this, he is quite restless. He cannot concentrate to anything, etc. But the situation is under control, because I know what is going on. And he has begun to recognize his own behavior too. I can sense he is worried because he is aware of my disclosure and the spooky calls, and that at the same time he is under the command too. Not easy part to play for him. Now I'm being played off the field by the reptiles and the hive mind synchronized events. I live in the middle of the forest on a pension disability. I cannot move long distances and my memory is playing tricks on me. They did a great job. Also at the same time I can sense a relief. I feel something is moving away from my life. And I begin to see life differently, being more present. The reptilians and shadow government have changed their tactics. After such a long period of negativity, good accidents have started happen. I'm holding my breath. I know these synchronized events are manipulated as the previous years of my life, but I can handle that by not being emotionally too attached with these events. Even though I know I cannot ever really be free from this mess, there is a pause from negative tactics and I have waited for that. So this whole thing means that we are having negotiations of my limited freedom. I'm being given threats on my life in VRE, and at the same time I'm being given candies as well. As one can understand, the issue of alien manipulated relationships and events are, in my opinion, much more important than an isolated study of abduction experiences. Only by seeing a bigger alien picture can we understand the overall impact aliens have in our lives. They own us. They control us. And this happens in ordinary relationships all over the world. This is what Barbara Bartholik and myself have believed for years. 10. Have you ever seen or observed the human clones in your experiences? Yes, I have. In a dump, I have seen my clone. Somehow it was not properly made. The tissues looked puffy. This creature could barely walk and it was wobbling. Movements were very clumsy and the scenario reminded me of the Frankenstein story. Somehow I believe human participants made this clone. In UFO craft I have consciously seen male clones, lots of them, lying on the tables. I saw this accidentally when a hybrid creature was showing me the way to somewhere. I think this was not meant for my eyes to observe, but accidents do happen. I strongly believe that almost 13 years ago, my original body was killed and used somehow. My consciousness was put into cloned body. This happened to Ted Rice and was elaborated on in the late Dr. Carla Turner's Masquerade of Angels book L. At that time I felt physically different and looked younger. My friend also told me that I looked different. But I have no conscious memories of this. Only my instinct. The procedure was conducted after very sadomasochistic events by the Reptiids and humans, which I do not want to go into specific detail. But the process of soul recycling, after being born into a body, begins after abductees are given some sort of liquid to drink. I had to drink it as well as a couple I had not seen before. What happened to them, I don't know. I also experienced being killed, in a ritualized fashion, a second time in the autumn 2010, a similar procedure, and I have conscious memories of that incident. I was spontaneously awakened in the 2010 storage in a black box procedure, where the pure consciousness, essence of me was temporarily kept. I know these issues are frightening and sound psychotic. Only a very strong person is able to go deeply into these disturbing experiences without being shocked. The denial of these soul recycling procedures is natural for humans, and I can understand that clearly. I'm telling this, because the facts and witness testimonies cannot be ignored forever. Behind the surface there are more things happening than friendly discussions with the Space Brothers. I can give you one thought to contemplate: what the term karma is given to people as a justifier for their memories of previous lives, which they lived because their consciousnesses had been recycled by the aliens, may not be because of the karmic law. In my opinion, we don't know what is the natural process of consciousness to transform or move forward. We only know that we have been told to behave, or otherwise we could wake up as pigs. We are being told that we remember past live because of reincarnation, not because someone has reincarnated us. There is a huge difference here, and I believe the technology for doing this is being kept hidden, and it would be very precious for humanity if they don't already have it.